The gospel of this morning, the church has us read one of the great miracles of Christ, one of the few miracles in which he resurrects the dead. As you just heard, the miracles happened to the widow of Nain, a woman who has already struck by misfortune. Within its time and its context, there are two categories that are always challenged. One category is that of the orphan in the ancient world. If you have no one to take care of you, the other is of the widow. And this woman here is struck by two calamities. The first is that she is a widow. The second is that her one son, the one son who would provide for her, who would look out for her, who would represent her in every issue, whether it's social, whether it's legal, it is the son. This is a time in which women had very few rights or privileges. A woman was always had recourse to some male of her family. If it's not her father, then her husband. If it's not her husband, it's her son. And this woman has no recourse to any of them. So this moment of great disaster for her, of the greatest sorrow upon sorrow, as she is going with the crowd is following her, the son already dead, they are taking him outside of the city. He is just about to be buried. In all of pre-modern times, the cemeteries are always outside of cities. And it's at this greatest moment of sorrow for her that the Lord steps in. And the language of the scripture is so clear and so crisp and so wonderful. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her. He had compassion on her and said to her, "Do not weep. Do not weep." These instructions that come through the scriptures have to provide us with comfort. Last night, the instruction from Christ was, "Do not be afraid." And this morning it is, "Do not weep." It is very important to note that the woman herself didn't say anything. Out of the miracles of Christ, there's so many miracles of Christ, we see some that asked for his miracles, some that pleaded, some that begged. This woman just cried. But she didn't ask Christ for the miracle. Simply by seeing her and seeing her state, Christ had compassion on her. We worship not only a mighty God, but a benevolent God. A God who loves his creation, who interacts with his creation, who has mercy on his creation. This is not the God of the philosophers or the deist or the clockmaker God who kind of creates everything and leaves, checks out. This is a God who not only creates but is intimately connected with his creation. St. Paul puts it best in his epistle to the Hebrews when he speaks that we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with us. And this has to give us great comfort, that our high priest, our Lord and Savior, knows of our sorrows, knows of our problems, and is able to sympathize, to understand those problems on a very, very personal basis. The miracle itself is one of the great miracles that highlights the prophetic role of Christ. Christ as the prophet. You have a woman who lost her son. Christ resurrects the son, raises the son, and then hands the son back to his mother. You'll see that among the Old Testament prophets, with Elijah and Elisha, both of them perform very similar miracles. Both of them are interacting with widows that lose their sons. Both of them raise the sons. And in both cases, they hand the son back to their mothers. On one hand, the miracle emphasizes the prophetic role of Christ, that Christ is the prophet. On the other hand, it clearly states that he is much more than a prophet, that even though he is fulfilling the prophetic role that is set by the Old Testament, that he is much more than a mere prophet. When you look at Elijah in 1 Kings, Elijah, before doing anything, he prays to God. When you look at Elisha in 2 Kings, before he does anything, he is praying to God. When we look at Christ, Christ commands. Christ commands the dead man, young man, I say to you, arise. The miracles of Christ are constantly doing this. They are constantly showing us that he is the prophet and the priest and the king, and on the other hand, that he is much more than any of those categories. Young man, I say to you, arise. Within our society and within the time that we're in, where there is a cottage industry of checking our faith, of doubting our faith, of presenting Christ as a misunderstood rabbi, as a misunderstood miracle worker. The language of the scriptures comes through to reaffirm our faith, that he is much more than any of that. Within this cottage industry of this whole Jesus versus Christ deal that comes through in the media, that comes through in our universities, that comes through in the books that you read, and the news articles that you pursue, anything that deals with Christ, the thing that's in vogue is the Christ of faith and the Jesus of history, where you have Jesus being the rabbi, but it's somehow, by the end of the first century, it's the Christians that make him a god, that they kind of misunderstand who Jesus was. In the language of the scriptures, and this is important, the reading of today is from the Gospel of Luke. It is not of John. The divinity of Christ comes through loud and clear in the last gospel that is written, the Gospel of John. But this is the Gospel of Luke. This is the Gospel of Luke. But the divinity of Jesus, that Jesus is the Christ, cannot be questioned. Where the prophets are asking for God's prayer for the world, that are interceding on behalf of God, Christ repeatedly, over and over again, in all of his miracles, he commands, he acts, he raises the young man based on his authority, on his ability to say, young man, I say to you, arise. The prophetic role of Christ in this miracle also comes through from the very last verse. In the last verse says, the crowd, now keep in mind that this is a huge crowd because it was two crowds. Notice at the very beginning of the gospel of this morning, Christ is entering the city, and as the scripture says, and many of his disciples went with him and a large crowd. So there's one large crowd with Christ as he's entering the city, and the woman with her dead son exiting the city also with a great crowd, and it's at the gate of the city that these two crowds converge and that the miracle takes place before them all. And upon seeing this great miracle, they say that a great prophet has risen up amongst us and God has visited his people. A great prophet has risen amongst us. This is an echo of the departing words of Moses. Moses, and as he is leaving the Israelites, he gives them his parting speech, and part of it is the promise that God will send them a prophet, that the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me. The miracle just seeping with the prophetic role of Christ. As marvelous as it is, the miracle, really we cannot view this as something unique. This is an ongoing miracle. It's a miracle of going from death to life. from being really, not only dead, but he's minutes away from being in the ground. And yet he becomes alive. And in all of our lives, whenever we convert, whenever we repent, whenever we leave sin and darkness and turn to the light of Christ, we are turning to the light of his resurrection. This miracle of going from death to life is an ongoing miracle. The miracle of today also has something to say about intercession. If we notice, the young man, of course, couldn't have pleaded. He is dead. But as we mentioned earlier, the mother herself didn't plead with Christ. It was the mother and this great crowd that surrounded her that was grieved with her grief that moved our Lord and Savior. And we've all experienced that. We've all attended countless funerals. Some, because of the circumstances, tend to be much more poignant, much more sorrowful than others. Sometimes in this intercessory role, so here Christ is not being asked to perform a miracle, but seeing the mother, the crowd, and their sorrow, he performs the miracle. And for us, sometimes we ask the Lord for things for ourselves. Other times we ask him for others, to have compassion on others, to bring back others. To an extent, this miracle assures us that our grief on behalf of others can lead to their salvation. Here it is with the dead child. We've encountered a similar miracle with the paralytic. Remember the paralytic that is carried by his four friends. And Jesus, seeing their faith, performs the miracle. Heals the man. Here he resurrects the child. It is important, though, that this function of the crowd, of the group, that it's not just simply the individual that is sorrowful, but it is the group that is sorrowful. It is for this reason that we get the church involved. This is why we send names up to the altar for Abuna to mention in his prayers. This is why we ask our friends to pray for us and to pray for specific things, so that Christ, seeing the crowd, whether it's the prayers of our friends or the prayer of the church body, through the commemoration of the priest, that he sees that crowd either in rejoicing when things happy take place or in sorrow. Repeatedly, the scriptures are emphasizing one thing. The encounter with Christ transforms. The encounter with Christ changes the heart, the mind, and the body. Now, this is the reading from today is from Luke chapter 7. A little bit farther down in the same chapter, the disciples of John the Baptist go to Christ and ask him, are you the one that we're awaiting? Are you the prophet? Or should we look for another? And his response, the response of Christ, is quite poignant. Go and tell John that you have what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, and the dead are raised. Each of these is a specific miracle. Each of them taking place in the physical, but all of them in the spiritual. With the healing, each of the healings of Christ, there is a forgiveness of sins, there's a healing of the spirit before there's a healing of the body. The healing of the body, in many ways, was just simply for those that doubted, those that witnessed the healing of the spirit and did not believe. How often he tells them, which is easier to do, which is easier to say. Each of these things provide us with hope, with healing, and with forgiveness. And it all goes back to Christ. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers cleansed, the deaf hear, and the dead are risen. If you are blind, we cannot see the glory of God. We have to approach God. We have to pray to God to give us sight. If we are deaf and cannot hear his words, and hear is understand his words, we have to pray to Christ. If we are dead because of the separation from him through sin, we are provided with that great miracle of repentance and forgiveness. Or if we have someone who is dead, a relative, a friend, let us take from the example of this sorrowful woman, the sorrowful woman with the crowd. Let us pray for them so that God, seeing our grief and that of the multitude, will have compassion on them as he had compassion on the woman on the woman and her son. And glory be to God forever. Amen.